the game. We are into the final game of this best of three between Harstam and Grubby. We have in the top three, in the top right, the green Protoss. He's Grubby.
Grubby.
And in the bottom right of Frost, one of the staple maps of StarCraft II these days, we have the pink Protoss. He is Fnatic's Harstam.
Yeah, Harstam.
I heard
a fangirl, not sure.
I have to agree with what you said, like, look at that guy's face. So focused, like, he's not jumping around like you mentioned earlier.
Yeah, yeah.
I've seen him do that a lot of times, like, he's listening to music and he's just going along with it.
Yeah,
he's
not
doing that, this is full focus, this is kill mode.
It's gone from party animal to predator.
That's actually a really good book. Well, let's see if he actually has some predator strategies ready here. Both players, of course, we are in the opening stages of the game. So they both still have actual time to think about their strategies. Frost, of course, the map is very different from the other two maps we just saw. Both maps before this were two-player maps where you know where your opponent is. So there's a higher risk of cheeses, proxy builds, you name it.
And the RNG god plays a role on this map as well.
You think so?
I think so. If you scout first on this map, it's very
important. Oh yeah, Harstam scouting the correct direction. I see what you mean. Yeah, that's a massive factor indeed. Grubby actually hasn't opted to send out a scout just yet. But this is already going to put Harstam in a really good position, you know? He could still proxy reactively at this point.
Yeah, I think this is great for Harstam. If Grubby now scouts the wrong direction or doesn't scout at all, that gives a huge advantage. It's a risk you take, because if Harstam sends out this probe scout and scouts Grubby last, it's actually disadvantageous. Because the probe's not going to see anything, but he does lose like 150 minerals in mining time. But because he does find Grubby first, it is actually a good decision.
I may be nitpicking here, but something seems really off about the gas timings of Grubby. I'm not saying he forgot his second gas, but he took a really long time to actually occupy his first assimilator, if anyone noticed that as well. And Harstam was actually mining 3 out of 3 on both as soon as possible.
I didn't pay attention to the gateway timing, but it's possible Grubby was actually going for something aggressive off of one gas and then saw the probe and thought, ah.
I can't do it anymore, yeah. So that's actually really good for Harstam here. Grubby at this point, can't really say that anyone is particularly ahead. Lucky for him, he is scouting the correct direction. If you look at the front of Harstam's base, we see the probe getting ready to come in, and there's nothing there to deny the scout. In fact, there is a Stargate now being built for Harstam, so Grubby will be able to spot this. That's a huge win.
Yeah. I don't know if he threw the Stargate down knowing the probe was there, but that's great for Grubby.
No, he couldn't have known. I don't think he saw the probe. He may have seen the probe leave, but he doesn't know which direction it went. Grubby actually finished Zealot, which is currently underway towards the base of Harstam. And there's actually already a Mothership core heading out onto the map here for Harstam. So maybe Grubby will try to bait it with the probe or something? I'm not sure. Harstam is in a good position to defend this.
I think what happened is that he did actually go for a quicker gate and just wants to make use of it by getting a Zealot out and putting some pressure on.
Oh, okay, so Grubby sacrifices his probe. I'm not sure why. Like, he didn't go for a second scout.
Maybe hoping to see a move out or something. Maybe just a mistake. I'm not sure.
All right. So regardless, the tech choice for Grubby has also been made. He is going for Twilight Council. Instead of Oracles, Harstam is going to go for Phoenixes. I really want to see if this is Blink. Like, if Grubby goes for Blink, he's technically in a better spot tech-wise. But no, it is the Dark Shrine, actually.
And it is the correct decision in this case. I guess, I'm not sure if you can still chrono out an Oracle, but he is making Phoenix. So technically, Harstam doesn't have direct detection.
No, he doesn't, but...
The Phoenix gives a lot of scouting information, though, so there is a high chance he'll actually see the Dark Shrine.
Yeah, I really do not... Well, okay, he's kind of sitting there. Okay, he's going to go into the mineral line. He will see the DT Shrine. No cancel on that for Grubby. He actually starts Blink the moment that Phoenix flies in. Is he going to cancel the DT Shrine? Well, not so far, but he is adding on gates at this point. Both players still on one base. Harstam actually responds by making a Robo Bay rather than an Oracle, which is a good decision because this DT Shrine is far from finishing and he has the time to make an... he's actually going for the Mothership Core.
I think both would be fine. I think delaying the Robo would be okay too, but I think having the Robo is just generally nice. So I agree with you. I think it's the better decision in this case.
Yeah, these Phoenixes are already being a massive nuisance. Picking at the Mothership Core, picking off probes. Both Phoenixes actually have one kill. So Grubby needs to keep on top of his probe production.
I really want to see Grubby cancel the Dark Shrine. Like, it's been scouted blatantly, and I don't like leaving that investment open.
Harstam flies in once more, takes a shot at the Mothership Core and forces the Photon Overcharge. Grubby is currently making one DT. But there is an observer as well on the way out, and the proxy pylon. Wait, where is that DT actually? Let me check that out.
He warped it in at home. It's not walking across the map.
Yeah, so I'm not really sure what this.
I guess it's just to prevent Harsim from going all in with his Stargate. Like, he forces there to be detection at home and with his army, preventing Harsim from putting on direct pressure right now.
Yep. Blink is still not finished. He's made his way half across the map. Grubby is still working on his map control, which is a good move. Even if you're against Phoenixes, which almost automatically grants you map control because of their mobility and because they're so good at picking off individual units, DT's actually managed to make his way into the natural, but this probe is having non-alphas. Wow, he's just going to get chased away. So this DT really not doing anything for Grubby.
I think it's fine, though. Like, I personally would have probably canceled the Dark Shrine, but I'm not a pro PvP player, so it's actually possible that the fact that there is a Dark Templar in the map is very beneficial to Grubby, in what Harsim is allowed to do now.
So let's look at this from a financial standpoint. Grubby has his Nexus up a slight bit earlier than Harsim did. He's slightly ahead in probes, negligible. Looking at the actual amount of upgrades, well, it's just Blink. And he's finally transitioning into Robo as well.
And he's getting plus one.
He's getting plus one as well. That's even bigger. Harsim is only just now getting his first four. So Grubby, he hasn't invested much in his army, but these Phoenixes at this point aren't really doing anything for Harsim anymore. They're scouting, which is of course very viable, but they're not going to be able to do all that much in an actual fight.
Yeah, I agree. I wonder if the decision to not make any more than one Phoenix is correct after you scout the Dark Shrine. I understand getting three allows for harass, but...
So funny misclick Grubby. He actually targeted his own assimilator with the Photon Overcharge.
It
didn't really matter. Well, actually, he could have sniped the one Phoenix, so that didn't
matter.
Yeah,
he could have killed the one Phoenix. So yeah. But you have to prepare for the Phoenix anyway. Like, you can't know if it is one or five, you know? Mm-hmm. So making just one, I feel, does the same job as making three.
So we're in a bit of a similar position where we were last game. We have both players on going for upgrades and getting Immortals. The question is Harsim once again going to transition into Tempest at a very strange point? Or is it going to be Colossi out of Grubby again? There's a lot of options here from both players, and I feel...
Grubby is getting quick charge, so I feel like Grubby is going to do one of those Archon Immortal timings where he does grab a third, but doesn't really probe it, and then just like shoves Harsim.
Yeah. Well, Archons, of course, are also a very good unit along with Immortals. However, unless you have Zealots on top of the Immortals, they are very difficult to deal with just Archons.
Yeah.
So he needs those charge slots to get a good position.
Plus, what you were mentioning last game, the problem with fighting with Immortals is that you can't break force fields like with Colossi. Archons alleviate that problem. So when you do have Archons in that mix, you're shoving power and your like pure A move power, as it were, becomes a lot more powerful.
Harsim, at this point, also has three sentries. Because we're talking PvP, we're talking force fields. You need sentries for force fields. Having a good sentry count is really going to help both players. Grubby, of course, also has two sentries with a bit more energy. So I feel both are in a really good position. Both are just kind of sitting there at their base. Harsim is actually well ahead in supply. He has a slight probe lead. I think he might be intending to take a third, though. He's being so passive.
Harsim's supply is up by two Immortals, a couple of Stalkers, and a couple of probes. It's good for him, but it's not like a...
It's not going to win you the game on its own.
If Harsim can't shove at Grubby and do anything, like, the amount of army supply he's ahead will be equal by the time he arrives at Grubby's
base. That's true. Defender's advantage plays a role when you're actually dealing with Immortals quite heavily. It's an interesting stalemate, though. Like, I feel both players are almost... Well, they're just playing very cautious. I wouldn't necessarily say they're afraid, but the level of caution they're both exerting is tremendous. And I finally see a move out here from Grubby.
Yeah, I think Harsim is slightly ahead in army supply, but I kind of started to like Grubby's position. Ooh. Seeing he's ahead in Templar, his plus two is going to start finish quicker, and if he's on top of it, he's going to have a quicker plus three.
Yeah.
And he's expanding already, whereas Grubby is very defensively minded and is probably thinking, I should be slightly ahead. I'm not going to give this away.
We have a signature move coming up here from Grubby. He's got a Warp Prism with a single High Templar in it. He's going to try and feedback the Mothership Core, but where is the Mothership Core? It's all... I don't actually see it. What, am I going blind?
It's... Oh, wait. It's between the main and the natural.
Oh, right.
The cliff next to the Temple Arc.
Oh, there it is. It was hiding on top of an assimilator.
This is a great position because they can overcharge both bases like quickly.
Yeah, Grubby would have to like fly around and drop behind the first assimilator. Very difficult to execute for Grubby. DT actually denies the third being built for Harstam, who now moves out down his entire army down the ramp. This is usually a case where a player could catch it, but it's really not happening. Grubby's probe count is currently equal, and he's getting his third, like I mentioned, a lot earlier than the Hearthstone.
I wonder if the DT actually got a kill. Yeah, the DT got one
kill. Probe.
I'm not sure if that's from earlier or if he just killed a probe that tried to
Yeah,
the Nexus.
Yeah, he denied it by killing the probe.
That's nice. That's like the little things, you know?
It's a little thing, but it can turn out to be a big thing. Both players are just still scouting each other out so much. We have another Hallucinated Phoenix here for Hearthstone, which actually spots the army of Grubby because he's moving underneath it. Harstam is kind of cleaning house, and at this point I'm a bit worried because the army supply of Harstam is actually massively in favor.
It is actually gigantically ahead, and I wonder like if that's enough to push it. Like it's 20 supply ahead, and that's mostly an army.
That
as well.
Plus three though.
That yeah, the upgrades are ahead for Grubby, and I feel like Grubby's third base being ahead and his army tactically army positioning, like moving forward with it. And taking map control by putting pylons around is allowing him to gain good position for the longer game.
This game is so analysis heavy. Like, there's not much happening to be excited about. I just want to see a good fight going down. Oh, here we go. Oh. Okay, so it's DT's actually being dropped along with Zealots. The Warpism should be able to escape just in time.
He saves the DT, which is most important.
He popped both forwards and overcharges, which is actually really good for Grubby.
That's good too. You're right.
Oh, another Zealot Warping by Harstam actually. Wow, it's like you think of the devil and boom, we got fights going on everywhere. I love it. Wow, so we got DT, Zealots actually being cleaned up, and Grubby, with this small move, actually climbs back up in supply.
Yeah, both of these players are very good at multitask harassing.
Double robo.
But not necessarily multitask defending.
Double robo all the way for Grubby. He's getting double Colossi as well as Thermal Lance. I feel once he gets four Colossi, he's got a very, very sweet timing on his hands. Along with plus three, which is still massively ahead of that of Harstam. Who doesn't even have Robotech or DTs at this point. Grubby, he's managed to somewhat capitalize on this, and now there's a massive warp in, but he gets can't. No! Two Zealots actually get warped in before the cannon manages to shoot down the warpism, but it gets cleaned up because of the... Look at the positioning of these cannons, that's awesome.
Yeah, it's really good.
Oh, look at the third of Harstam though. We got the army of Grubby now moving in. Two Colossi here. Another Hallucinated Phoenix get casted. Just to be able to see where the army of Harstam is, who is positioned atop that ramp with a ton of Archon Immortal. Holy crap.
He's still down, like 10 supply. So, even though...
Yeah, he shouldn't fight.
Yeah. I'm like, this is a bit scary. I would like for him to wait for a couple more Colossi, but he doesn't know if how far along Harstam is in his stack.
He can poke a bit, but it's still very dangerous.
It is.
Also, he doesn't want to lose the Time Warps, because there's a High Templar there for Harstam with feedback. If he loses the double Time Warp on his Mothership Core, that's huge. So both players have been going into Colossi, but Harstam still doesn't have thermal range, I believe.
Harstam's been up in supply almost the entire game, up till now.
Whoa,
and
those Grubby's immortals.
Always been ahead in tech.
He has seven Immortals. I still feel this is not a fight that Grubby can take. Look at the quality of these respective armies. Grubby actually has quite a lot of Zealots, which don't do a lot for this fight. Double Time Warp now goes down on the arm of Harstam. Is this the place where Grubby will fight? He's taking pokes
Harstam
at the army.
Harstam can't engage in this. He has to, like... this is painful.
This is very painful. Here comes the army. Not going very fast. Charging forward. Immortals trying to do as much damage as they can, but they are still taking fights from these Zealots here. We need another warp in here from Grubby, but Grubby's army supply is massively ahead.
The Colossi are just doing so much damage to the Zealots. The Archons are pushing forward, hitting Immortals. The aggressive warp in from Grubby, and this just seems over.
GG! Grubby takes this series 2-1 and advances on into the loser bracket. Unfortunately for Harstam, after a tremendous series against Grubby, he is unfortunately eliminated from the Dutch StarCraft League finals here at Epicon.